Welcome to the South Miami-Dade Cultural Arts Center Virtual Dance Talk for Dimensions Dance Theater of Miami. My name's Annie Hoffman. I use she, her pronouns, and I'm the Education and Outreach Manager at the South Miami-Dade Cultural Arts Center. This opportunity is brought to you with support of the Miami-Dade County Department of Cultural Affairs, the Board of County Commissioners, and the Office of the Mayor. Our program this evening will be recorded and made available with captions on our website at smdcac.org. Our panelists will be providing visual descriptions as they introduce themselves for those who are blind or have low vision. My visual description is, I have pale white skin, shoulder length straight blonde hair, I'm wearing glasses and a blue top. And behind me is a virtual background of the South Miami-Dade Cultural Arts Center. If you have any questions for our panel, please write them into the comments so that our panelists may answer them. I would now like to introduce our moderator, Jordan Levin, who will introduce our distinguished panelists. Thank you.
Thank you, Annie. Hi, everybody on Zoom and out there in virtual land. My name is Jordan Levin. I am a middle-aged white woman with chin-length gray-brown hair. I'm wearing a dark purple scoop neck top, and my background is a white wall and white floor with a little bit of an abstract theme. We are here with Adam Schnell, the artistic director of Vero Beach Ballet, Jennifer Cronenberg and Carlos Guerra, the co-directors and co-founders of Dimensions Dance Theater of Miami. We have a lot of people here. Giannis Eric Piqueras, a dancer and choreographer with Dimensions. Melissa Fernandez and Liran Verdecia, dancers with Ballet Hispanico, with many Miami connections and choreographers of one of the ballets that will be presented by Dimensions. And finally, Tony Siprasad, the violinist who will be performing live. And today's talk is about generations, family generations, artistic generations, community generations, organizational generations, all the layers that it takes to build an artistic community. And I'm gonna get to it right now with, going to start with Adam. So Adam, can you describe yourself briefly, and then I'd like to ask you, why did you start Ballet Vero Beach? It's an enormous challenge to run a ballet company. So tell us why and how.
So as Jordan said, my name is Adam Schnell. I am the artistic director and CEO of Ballet Vero Beach. My pronouns are he, him. I have just entered middle age. I have very, very lightly olive skin, dark brown hair, and I'm sitting in front of a lovely light blue wall with various windows. Jordan, that's a very tough question to answer. I ask myself that question every single day. Why did I start a ballet company? It's not an easy one to answer. Honestly, it was mostly because of my husband. We both retired from dancing about the same time and moved to Vero Beach and thought we were just going to go to the beach and teach some kids and be happy with our lives, and that was it. And about 3 years after living in Vero, he said to me, oh, don't you miss working with professionals? And I immediately bawled him out, as we said. I didn't want a company. I said, it's too much work. There's no way. What is wrong with you? Why would you want to do that to me? And after about a week of sort of being mad at him, I said, oh, you know, he's right. And there's so much philanthropy in Vero. And I don't know if our audience members know about Vero Beach, but we have more culture than we have any right to for a town and county of our size. We have the largest small town professional producing theater in America. We have a museum of art that's almost 40 years old, an opera company, several symphonies, and there was no professional dance. So I sort of took on that mantle. I have more wrinkles now than when we started about 8 years ago. And that's the long and the short of it. It was not my idea, in all honesty, and I tell everyone that every chance I can.
Jennifer and Carlos, I want to bring you in, but so briefly, how does that compare with your decision to start Dimensions? I know that's a complicated story, but it sounds like a very, you know, Adam and Camilo's reasons for starting their company is very different from yours.
Yes, well, let me start with a description of myself. So I'm Jennifer Cronenberg, co-founding artistic director of Dimensions Dance Theater of Miami. I'm going to choke a little bit as I say I'm entering middle age, but since Adam said it, I guess I should too. I have white skin, about, I don't know, longish brown hair. I'm wearing a navy blue top with white and pink flowers, and I'm sitting in front of a plain ivory background. Yes, we started, the reasons why we started Dimensions are a bit different from Adam's reasons for starting Vero Beach, but in a strange way, they parallel in that it's not something that either of us had planned, I think, very well before we set out and jumped off the cliff. We, I think, both did a lot of learning by doing. We're still both learning by doing, I think. He's a few steps ahead of me in that game, but he's certainly helping us out on our path. But it's very much the same. I mean, while Vero Beach might not have had a professional dance company, there are several professional dance companies here in Miami. So that's a little bit different. And for us, it was more about finding a niche that was missing, a void that was missing in that professional realm, with, you know, contemporary ballet, just a more of a smaller family feel to a ballet company. I feel like Miami City Ballet had that, of course, in the beginning, and then, you know, it grew and grew and grew, and now it's a major company, which is a whole different ball game. And there wasn't really any more, I don't know, small town, if you want to say small town in a big city, ballet company to go to, if that makes sense, a community oriented company. So we thought that we could fill that void a little bit.
And I wanted to say, so for Jennifer and Carlos, you're like second generation. If Miami City Ballet is the mama dance company, there are godmother dance companies, but we won't go there. But you are the second generation, and you were really well known in Miami as performers, right? So there was a kind of community family connection when you started Dimensions. People knew you. And then, of course, you had Ava. You know, people knew you as parents. Mm-hmm. And Adam, for you, you're starting, as you said, Vero Beach has a lot of culture, but it had no ballet company. So you're first generation. And I know you've been collaborating. Can you tell me how you've been collaborating, how you've been helping each other, and like what advice, if any, do you give each other? How do you help each other out? What do you tell each other? Since you gotta learn by doing.
Yeah, no, I think that for myself, I knew that being in a smaller town in a smaller area of Florida, like Vero Beach, we weren't going to start off and immediately have the funding to have a full resident professional company of even 10 dancers that we could employ for a full season and really make that work. So we started off working with a company in the Midwest, American Midwest Ballet, that's run by a former colleague of mine, and they were about 3 years in. So I said, oh, hey, if we can use your dancers and augment your season, we'll go up there and rehearse. People will come down from shows. It'll be great. We'll be able to have the same dancers without sort of having a pickup troupe feel, which was just something I wasn't interested in. I wanted to work with the same dancers and watch them grow. And that went, that relationship went for about 6 or 7 years. And oddly enough, I met Jen. I watched Jen and Carlos on stage for a very long time, but I met Jen teaching at a summer program in the Midwest. And she sort of came up to me and appeared by my side and grabbed my bicep and said, "You have a young company." I said, "Yes." She said, "I just started a company and you need to help me." And I said, "Well, of course." Like, and she's laughing, but it's true. That's absolutely how it happened. And I said, "Well, you're awesome. Of course. Like, let's figure out what to do." And it just started to make much more sense being, well, Carlos says I take a plane to Miami, but by driving 2 hours, it really takes 3 hours to drive between Vero and Miami, but it takes me two. Being 2 hours driving away from dancers that you're working with versus, you know, a half a day's plane ride. So it sort of made sense to start working together. We, Camilo and I, went to see some of their shows. We really sort of fell in love with them and the dancers and, of course, Eva. And so we developed what we like to call a sister company relationship, which basically means we sort of intersect at the artist, and we're now just getting to a place where we're also intersecting at the repertoire. And it's phenomenal. They're great people. I love all the dancers at Dimensions, and it has, you're talking about generations and families and things like that. It started to feel like the two organizations have really started to blend. And even to the point where Ballet Vero Beach just got to the point where we have our own resident dancers. We now have three, but they're all sort of, they blend together as a family when we go to Miami or when we have shows up in Vero. And it could not be a better relationship for me. In terms of advice, Carlos keeps us laughing, and Jen and I just walk up to each other and say, "It's going to be okay." And we trade off on that. Like, it's not just me saying it to her. Like, every once in a while, she'll just text me and she said, "It's going to be okay." And I'll be like, "How does she know that I'm about to jump off the cliff? I just don't understand." But yeah, it's been phenomenal. And I think that spirit of collaboration really helps us both do more with less and really give more to the artists than either one of us could on our own.
Wonderful. Jennifer and Carlos, how was the relationship from your perspective? Why did you want to do this? You know, once you got going, how does it help Dimensions? How does it enrich what you do?
My name is Carlos Guerra. I am a co-founder and artistic director of Dimension Dance Theater of Miami. I have a white skin male with dark brown hair, and I'm sitting right in front of an ivory curtain. So back to your question, it's been wonderful, the collaboration that we have with Ballet Vero Beach, and it has helped us to offer our dancers more weeks in their contracts by that, and I guess it helps each other in that way. And also it is very important for us to expand also to a different community and a different city as well, so to spread our names of the company. And, you know, it's been wonderful, and it's so easy to work with these directors there from Vero Beach, and the dancers are wonderful. And every time, as Adam said before, when we get together, it's amazing what we can do on the studio and then what we can bring back on the stage.
Mm-hmm. It's a great support system. You know, there's artistic support, administrative support, emotional support. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, it allows us to offer the dancers not only expanded weeks, but expanded repertoire. It's a really lovely gift, I think, to be able to have that relationship.
And if I can jump in, because Jen said emotional support, and especially throughout the pandemic, but even before that, I feel like, as especially in ballet, we're all expected to be so strong and so steely. Like, there's no, you don't show weakness, right? You don't say, "Oh, there's no way I could do that step. I can't do that lift. I can't do that turn." Right. And then as artistic directors, you're supposed to know everything to do at every moment of the day. And to be able to have people that you can say, "I am really struggling with this decision," or, "Oh my God, can you believe this wonder asked this of me," or anything like that, or just to be there and to be going through something very similar, especially in the past year and a half. It's been, I mean, I don't know if I personally would have been able to get through the past year and a half without this relationship, honestly.
I hope I'm not coming down too heavy on the parenting, the parent metaphors, but you know, it's like parenting. It's like, those are the decisions only you can make. You can get all the advice you like, but at the end, you're the only one who can decide. And it's terrifying and liberating in a funny way, because you're like, okay, this is me, I'm gonna do it. Adam, tell me about you or both of you, you and Dimensions, commissioned Around Midnight. Why did you commission Yannis Eric? Was this the first time, or?
It was our first commission with Yannis Eric. Ballet Vero Beach commissioned the piece originally. And honestly, again, talking about family and generations and everything like that, I was a young choreographer once, a little younger than Yannis Eric by a year or two. And my first job out of high school was with Sarasota Ballet when Robert DeWarren was there. And I didn't find this out at the time. He did not like me as a dancer, but he hired me because he knew I wanted to be a choreographer. And at one point, he was a young choreographer way, way back with Sadler's Wells, before Royal Ballet, and somebody gave him his start. So he started letting me choreograph in the school. And by my second year, I was named resident choreographer and I was choreographing for the company. So when I started Ballet Vero Beach, I knew that it couldn't be a selfish endeavor. I couldn't do it just for me because it's too hard. You get tired and you just want to stop. If you're being truly selfish, you would close the company and say, see you later, I'm going to go lie on the beach. Mm-hmm. So I knew I wanted to encourage young dancers, young choreographers, young musicians, anybody I could that I felt really wanted to put their artistic voice out into the world. And a couple of summers ago, one of the ways we started working together, Dimensions and Ballet Vero Beach, is we brought them up for our summer festival, which basically presents small contemporary companies from all over the United States in Vero. Each summer we bring one, and we brought Dimensions. And Yannis Eric, I will never forget this, he was working with the B team of students that were there to learn. I think it was Billie Eilish, right, Yannis Eric? He was using a Billie Eilish song, like he had taken all the lyrics out, or maybe there's a remix. I'm not young enough to know if it was like a remix or whatever that. But so there's this moment in the song where it goes just to snapping. And he had, excuse me, the most untalented dancers doing the most musical choreography I had seen in a long time. And I went, okay, so we're gonna have to do something with this one. And so the opportunity came up. We were supposed to have a collaboration with one of the symphony orchestras up in Indian River County. It got postponed because of the pandemic, but we were able to finish the commission for actually our return to live performances this past January in Vero, and even expand the commission with him so that he could do the whole work. And yeah, that's the story of how it came about. He has a unique voice, a unique musicality, a unique vocabulary. And I think it's really fun for me to see young artists get a chance and be able to be pushed in new directions.
It's wonderful that you were given a chance when you were a young dancer by Robert Warren, you know, and he paid it forward, and now you're paying it with Yannis Eric. Yannis, tell us about, I'm going to get a little personal here. So your father, Yannis Piqueras, was the first male star of Miami City Ballet when it was founded in 1986. And he and your mother have been dance figures in Miami since then. First as dancers, then your father running Max Fun Dance Company, and all along as heads of Miami Youth Ballet. So what has it been like for you to come into your own as a dancer, and then more recently as a choreographer with that kind of history? Is it inspiring? Is it a little, did you ever think, why did you choose to stay in Miami instead of, you know, maybe go somewhere else?
So first off, I have white skin. I have short brown hair. I'm wearing a light blue shirt. I'm sitting in front of a gray wall with some dance photos. In fact, that's a photo of my parents right there. And yeah, that's a great question. So growing up, I was growing up around this like company environment, very similar to Den and Carlos's daughter, who is like our little mascot. I was that for Maximum Dance because my dad had a ballet company for many years in like the early 2000s. So growing up, I was always around that, and I was always around those ballets that he had been choreographing. And I don't think that I had really understood what that was at the time. They were just people dancing things. I didn't really realize that these were things that he himself was choreographing because he was just dad, you know? And I wasn't studying to dance at the time. I was, I think for the longest time, thinking that I was going to be a filmmaker or go into like the movie business or something, because that was always my thing. And it wasn't until like my like kind of almost late teens that I decided that I really do love dance and I should dance. And I think that was when I started understanding that like my parents had a pretty cool job growing up. You know, they were dancers. They were on stage, and my dad choreographed these things, and my mom danced these things, and now they have a school. And so that all came to me, and I realized that, you know, that's something that I would love to follow in the footsteps of, because I was super inspired by it, and I, you know, I'm still in awe sometimes when I see them, you know, videos of them dancing. I'm like, oh my gosh, that's so cool. Those are my parents. So that kind of, it created a late start in me, but it definitely kind of made me want to push myself and say, I started really late, so like, let me give this a go and see how it goes. And so I ended up also going to Miami City Ballet, where they were, which was interesting with the background, because of course all my teachers knew who they were. I was always compared and, you know, et cetera. But that was also the first time that I was given the opportunity to choreograph anything, which I didn't know that I wanted to do.
Ballet.
Yes, so we had a composition class. My second year in Miami City Ballet, they added a composition class as part of the curriculum.
How old were you?
Like 18 or 19? I had just graduated high school. And so it was the first time they basically asked, you know, who wanted to actually start a piece. We all had to like do a little bit of something, but then the ones who were more serious about it were allowed to continue. And so we were choreographing on our classmates, and I got really into it. I decided that I was like, I'm gonna try this and see how it goes. And I didn't know what I was doing. And at the time I had seen a lot of ballet, and I had choreographers that I really enjoyed. But it was funny that in all of that time, I never went back to the fact that, oh, my dad choreographs. Like it was this weird separation where I was trying to do my own thing. But then, you know, it was what it was. It was okay. It wasn't great. And in years after that, I also had a chance to choreograph at Charlotte Ballet, where I went after Miami City Ballet. And those were fine. But it wasn't until I came back here to Miami, and I was now back for real home and back in our studio, which I'm in now. And I got to work with my parents' students from the school. That I think that's when I really started realizing where I had evolved to and how I was starting to find my voice, because now I wasn't under pressure. I wasn't, you know, with like working on classmates and friends where it gets a little weird. And I finally had the time to kind of like decide who I was, and, you know, which is a little different than what my dad choreographs. And it's a little different from the things that Maximum Dance was doing, but that was like a starting point. And then over the time at Miami City Ballet and over the time at Charlotte Ballet, I had worked with so many different people that it kind of became this like melting pot of things that I knew that I liked and you know, music that I liked that maybe he wouldn't pick, or, you know, but then it's funny when I talk to people about it, a lot of people will find similarities between us, which unintentionally, because I'm not trying to, but sometimes there are a lot of things that I think that just, because it's family and because of our personalities, we're very similar people. We unintentionally happen to have the same kind of ideas for things and the same kind of mentality when it comes to choreographing things as well. So yeah, that was a very mishmash answer, but it's interesting. It's like a very, it's like a, it's like a circle, but it's like not a, I don't know. It's interesting. And especially being sharing a program with him and dancing his ballet, but then also choreographing my ballet. It's like, it's interesting. I don't know. It's an interesting, there's a lot of layers and there's a lot of things that I noticed that now dancing his ballets in dimensions, things that I didn't notice when I watched them, when I was watching Maximum Dance, but now that I'm doing them, I'm like, so that's what that was, or, oh, that's how that was. And it just kind of feels right. A lot of the things just feel like things that I would do. But then I see the things that I'm choreographing and then I'm like finding the similarities. There's a lot of layers. So it's weird. It's, there's no like straight answer for it.
That's okay. And you're going to figure out more dimensions to that answer.
Oh, for sure.
And it's interesting that for some people, I would imagine the weight of family and parents might not have been conducive to creativity, but it sounds like for you, there was a familiarity and a comfort and a confidence and, you know, this is home and I can do what I want and try things out without the pressure of proving yourself in another kind of situation, in another kind of professional situation. So it sounds like in your case, it was a good thing. And so many things to ask. I want to ask you about the piece, but Jennifer and Carlos, we've already heard from Adam on why he thought it was important to commission Adam to foster young choreographers. Why did you start asking him to create ballets for Dimension?
Well, one of the things is like we started seeing Giannis choreographing for the Miami Youth Ballet for the school, and he always was coming with ideas, telling us, oh, I thought about this and this and that, you know, what he had in mind. And we thought that he was, he's very talented. And part of our mission in the company is to work with local young choreographers, give the opportunity as well, you know? So that's how we decided to, I think it's time for, you know, to give him a chance and to choreograph for the company. And see, one of the first pieces that he made was for the Lab Theater. And then we decide to take it and expand the piece to take it to the main theater. So we are extremely happy with his work and we believe in him a lot. And so, yeah.
Yeah, we gave him the ball and he went running with it. And every piece that he's done one after another has been better than the one before it. And it's really incredible to sit and watch him in the studio because he almost never gets stuck. That's not to say he doesn't go back and change things, but the choreography just sort of flows right out of him and you see the ideas like forming as he's doing it. And it's really something. It's rare. He has a gift. It's wonderful. It's wonderful to see. And if we can continue giving him the opportunity and nurturing that gift, fantastic, you know.
It's amazing to see the dancers working with him because he's not like there are some other choreographers that come with an idea and then they see they stop and then you know the dancers start getting cold, but he comes with this idea in his mind and he just don't stop working. He keeps the dancers working the whole time, yeah, immediately. So it's
the rehearsals are incredibly active. Very active. And he really is the kind of choreographer that takes physical suggestion from the dancers. He doesn't come in with a set idea and it has to be this way and this is what I want. He'll really work with the dancers that he has and get inspired by them, which is it's unique. Not all artists do that.
It's so interesting to hear and it must be so exciting to be part of this process, all of you. And again, almost as a family because of the size of the company, of both your companies. And the intimacy of that and how close all of you are. Giannis, Eric, tell us a little, I want to get to Melissa and Levon and their story, but tell us about your piece Around Midnight. Tell us about the music. Tell us about any, just tell us about it. Is it different from other works that you've done so far?
A little bit. I think it's a little bit more on the neoclassical side, but more towards classical. I feel like there's a lot of moments that are a little bit more ballet oriented than things that I usually choreograph. When Adam first showed me the music, I had no idea what I was going to do with it because it sounded very difficult. And actually, after also you know, talking to Tony, our violinist, and the other musicians, I also understand that it's very difficult to play.
What is the name of the music, a composition?
Yes, it's called, I believe it's called Serenade in C by Erno Donani, who's a Hungarian composer. And so when I first heard it, I was trying to think of, like, how do I figure this out? What do I do with it? So I kind of tried to find influence in different places, and I started looking into a lot of Hungarian contemporary art just to find a parallel between, since he's a Hungarian composer, and I was curious what kind of contemporary artists, what kind of work they were doing over there. So I found this artist named Robert Pellis, who has these incredibly abstract paintings that have, like, these really hard edges that blend into, like, very soft little patterns and stuff. And for some reason I saw it and I was like, that kind of matches the music in my head. You know, the music has a lot of very sharp accents and notes, but then it has a lot of lyrical moments that get very classical and pretty. And so I decided to mirror that with the choreography as well and find moments to be very sharp and energetic and fast, and then also moments where it could be a little bit more classical and languid and maybe romantic. And the piece is very abstract, but it's a piece based on a painting that matched the music, basically, unofficially. But they all kind of inspired each other, and the painting inspired the color palette and things like that. But it's definitely, it's very fast. It's very fast, it's very active, no one stops moving. it's definitely a very difficult piece to dance and also a very difficult piece to play for the musicians, but all of it together is very exciting.
Tony, I want to bring you into the conversation. Can you tell us a little bit more about this piece of music? And tell us what it's like as a musician to play for dance versus when you're the center of attention in a chamber music concert.
Hi, I'm Tony. I have medium brown skin. Maybe it's darker in the video. I have dark brown hair, maroon colored shirt, a cobalt colored wall behind me, and an abstract painting. And to answer your question, the Donyani Serenade in C major, it's quite difficult. It's in five movements, and it ranges from the first movement is maybe just a few minutes, and it's a bit of a march, and then it goes into something much more romantic in the second movement. In the third movement, it is just black notes on the page and full speed ahead. In a very complicated, kind of intricate rhythmic pattern, which is quite a challenge for a trio of musicians to play. It's written for violin, viola, and cello. And the violist is Ross DeBartolabin, and the cellist is Ashley Gerritsen. All three of us did our degrees at the University of Miami, so we've all been down here for a little while. And also I play in the Miami City Ballet, which I actually never met Jennifer and Carlos in the 10 years that I was there. So something that's a little interesting about playing for dance, usually dancers and musicians are so separate in companies. Like we never meet each other. We pass each other every once in a while in the hallways, getting to the parking garage before it gets too packed to get out. In 10 years, I never really saw or met Jennifer and Carlos. And their company is different from many of the dance companies that I've worked with in that I do feel a much more collaborative spirit. They seem to take a lot of maybe concern of their dancers and musicians to make sure everybody is really working together in synergy. So I really appreciate that. One of the struggles, or maybe differences, challenges playing with dance is that tempo is much more important playing for dancers than it is in chamber music concerts or with opera or with other forms, because they are rehearsing to recordings. And these recordings oftentimes are not just one tempo from beginning to end. They have lots of push and pull and accelerandos and ritardandos. And as a musician, when we're listening to it before we have our first rehearsal, we're trying to listen to this, you know, 20 minutes of music and map out every place where they're taking a little time and moving forward. And it's very hard to get that into the body to match it exactly with what they're doing. So we spend a lot of time listening over and over, trying to get the right tempos that the dancers are comfortable with. And by the way, Yanis, I got your email and I will be working on those sections from our recordings this week. So yeah, it is very difficult in that way, particularly with tempo being the main element that you're focusing on as a musician, as opposed to dynamic range, volume, you know, loud or soft, or maybe the perfect intonation or articulation. So that's probably what makes it a little bit different, is that tempo is an issue. And also, if we're broadcasting, another issue is, which we've done before, I don't know if we're doing it this time, but being able to get the right sound mix with the theater when something gets broadcast to the public on Facebook or social media is that whole miking system can be quite a challenge to make sure that the people at home are hearing what the people in the audience are hearing. So
it's, yeah. And I want to get on to Melissa and Levan, but I noticed there were occasions with Miami City Ballet. Remember the Cleveland Orchestra, correct? That when you have an orchestra, that you have musicians that are tuned into dancers, it brings the performance alive in a way that nothing else can. And I don't know how much you'll be playing with for dance in the future, but I do know that it can make performances so exciting because it amplifies the performance energy. You have two sets of different artists and live in the moment, in the instant, they're responding to each other. They can't help it, it's what they do. So although I won't be there, I'm out of town, but I know it'll be an exciting experience for you all. I have to get to Melissa and Levan. So you are both dancers with Ballet Hispanico. Melissa, you are from Miami, and Levan, I believe you're from Cuba. I'm gonna let you describe yourselves and then I'm gonna ask a question.
Yes, hello, my name is Melissa Fernandez Verdesia. I am a 32-year-old woman. I have dark black hair that is slicked back right now. I have light tan skin. I'm wearing a white dress with red and green flowers. And our backdrop is a light blue wall with a big picture of an older Cuban woman smoking a cigar.
Hello, my name is Levan Verdesia. I have light brown skin. I'm wearing a blue shirt. And as Melissa, my back is a blue wall with a big painting of a Cuban woman smoking cigar too.
So tell us your story. Melissa, tell me your story about being from Miami. Levan, tell us about how you came to dance in New York, and tell us how you became a couple. And then tell us about, well, let's start with that. And then we'll go.
Yeah, no, that's a lot right there. But firstly, I want to say, like, I'm so honored to be part of this conversation because the topic of generations is so poignant, especially for me, because as you alluded to at the beginning, so I'm from Miami. I grew up there and I started dancing with Maria Elena and Yanis at their studio when I was, I don't know, like 13 or something. But as a little girl, my mom would take me to see Miami City Ballet dance, and Jennifer and Carlos were my favorite couple. I did have a picture of them when they appeared in Dance Magazine, and I cut it out and I pasted it on my wall. And it's funny how life is, it's a small world, especially the dance world, and how things come full circle in a sense, because never in my wildest dreams did I ever imagine that I'd be working so closely with them. And also it's beautiful because I grew up watching Yanis Eric grow up. And I remember when I was like, wow, he's so talented. Like he should dance, but he didn't want to dance. And then when he finally did. And now I see him blossoming as a choreographer. And so all these circles and transitions are being made, and it just makes me feel so grateful. So I want to mention that. But so yeah, I grew up in Miami. I trained in Miami, and then I went to college. I moved to New York because I was accepted into the Juilliard School. And since then, after graduating, I joined Ballet Hispanico. So I've lived in New York now for like 14 years and mm-hmm. danced with Ballet Hispanico for 10 years. Mm-hmm. But I always find my way back home because, you know, there's no place like home. And I always felt very supported artistically and emotionally. Mm-hmm. And especially at Miami Youth Ballet, like they are my family. And now to see them joining forces with Carlos and Jennifer, who, you know, because Miami City Ballet was a very big part of Maria Elena and Yanis's past and now present. So when initially, a couple years ago, Carlos and Jen asked me to choreograph on their company back when it was more just beginning. And it was a beautiful experience to work with their dancers, because it has been mentioned here, the company has a very familial feeling. It's very warm and inviting, and the dancers are incredibly talented and bring so much from their own cultures mm-hmm. and their training and their background. And so it was a great challenge for me to work with such a classical or neoclassical company, because of my training at Juilliard and Ballet Hispanico, I had moved from like classical to a more contemporary style, and now bringing that style to these dancers and challenging them to move in different ways was a great challenge for me, and it was exciting, and it also helped me as a choreographer understand where I needed to grow. Mm-hmm. And so later on, two years later, when Carlos asked Livang and I to set a duet that we made on his company, I was really excited to tackle that again and have another experience with his company. Mm-hmm. But regarding that duet, I think you can talk about that.
Yeah. Before, I want to hear about the creation of Maria. And mm-hmm. But first, tell us a little bit about yourself and where you're from and how you got to Ballet Hispanico.
Yes, it's a long story, so I'm gonna make it short. I started training when I was training classical ballet when I was 9 years old, and I danced for the National Ballet of Cuba for two years and a half. When I met Ballet Hispanico back in 2014 in a ballet festival in Havana, so I met Ballet Hispanico and went to rehearsal in Cuba. And I saw them dancing, and all the pieces they were doing were Spanish or Cuban music, and they were dancing contemporary. I don't know. I felt a connection, and as many Cuban we defected, and I took a chance, and I had the opportunity to go to Canada on tour with the National Ballet. With the company. So I decided not to come back to Cuba, and I stay in Canada. I crossed the border and I went to Miami until I had my papers. And fortunately, I worked with a choreographer while I was in Cuba. And this choreographer have worked with Ballet Hispanico previous years. And she, Anabel Lopez Ochoa, she was the one to really help me to get my foot into Ballet Hispanico. So I joined Ballet Hispanico in August 2015, where I started dancing more contemporary as well. I was in Cuba, I did more classical, but also in Cuba, I had the opportunity to set two duets, two neoclassical contemporary duets for the National Ballet in Cuba. And now I'm doing more contemporary. So I'm in this stage where I like to combine them all. Lo mismo, like salsa music, but more contemporary, or like use more classical steps. So that's a little bit of my story. I think you asked me about Maria, right?
I do want to hear about Maria. I just, as you were telling me that story, I thought of another, there are so many connections between Miami and Cuba and every area of life. But in dance, I've seen when I was at the Miami Herald, I many times covered the stories of dancers who defected from Cuba to the United States. And I've also seen how dancer, you know, companies from the US go to Cuba and influence things there, or companies from Cuba come here and interact with Cuban American dancers and artists. And there's just, there is restricted by politics and controversy, but there's still a lot of back and forth between people and between artists that I think is very good for both.
Yeah.
But tell me, I'm sorry, did you want to say something about
that? No. I just want to add it. Culture and dance, I believe it doesn't have borders. You know, like we go to anywhere with dancing. And unfortunately, politics, it make us a little restricted, but dance in like culture in general is free, it's in the air. So we can go anywhere.
So tell me about making Maria. You were a couple, correct?
Yes.
Tell us about that.
We had the opportunity to work with a Peter London.
Global dance company.
Yes.
A modern dance company, or cultural modern dance company in South Florida.
Yeah, and they had a holiday Christmas.
Their winter show falls during like the last week of December. And I had been working with, so Peter London was my former teacher when I attended New World School of the Arts. Mm. And since 2015, he had every year commissioned me to create a piece on his dancers. And this, when we made Maria, he wanted me, because he knew that Livan was a dancer and had choreographic history. He said, why don't you guys choreograph something together? So that was like the seed that then expanded.
Yeah.
And were you already a couple at that point?
Yes.
Yeah, we had been dating for a year.
Yeah. I would say 2 years.
Two years.
And I don't know, it was a really, and I always say this, it was a really short process, because we had one or two days to set the piece.
Yeah.
And we did it like after we got engaged. Melissa also, she was doing like a rehearsal director for Peter London's company.
Yeah.
So a lot of things were going on, and we had to make this duet. Mm-hmm. And we chose the music of Michael
Bublé.
Yeah, Michael Bublé's rendition.
We had this idea of taking this the story, but making a little bit outside of the story, if that makes sense. And we just, I mean, dance, you can create anything, right? You everything that is in your mind, you can reflect in dancing. And we created, and she was Maria, and at the same time I was the angel Gabriel, but I was her husband too. And we just went back and forth, and movement is so rich that make the dancer or the choreographer explore. And we created this image of being in the living room, and the Maria and this woman was going back home from work, and she just found out that she was pregnant. I don't know how, because she didn't had a husband, but in her head, she was pregnant and she had a husband, right? So
she's looking into the future.
Yeah. And it was an interesting a process, and ideas were all over the places, but I don't know. Well,
yeah, like for us, for me, I love that story, especially because it coincided with Christmas when we choreographed it, now that I'm in retrospect. And for me, that story has always been very meaningful to me. The fact that Mary was, there was an apparition and she got this beautiful news that she was bearing Christ. And so, and the song itself, Ave Maria, is so iconic. I feel like all across the board, every culture has a version of it. So when we decided on that song, I was like, you know, I don't want it to be, you know, it doesn't have to be anything tied to religion or anything. It's a feeling. And I think that feeling of innocence and expectation and hope. And when we choreographed it again, it was a short amount of time, but I think our energies were flowing and our minds were, we were like on the same page. And so ultimately the point of the piece was to create like a snapshot of someone's life. And I think it was like parallel to ours, mm-hmm. and what we wanted for the future. Cause it's funny now that we are sitting here talking about it, we have a 6-month-old.
I have to get to that part of the story. And then you became engaged right after that. And yeah. Then how much longer after that did you become pregnant?
Well, so this, we premiered this piece in 2017. And then we got married in 18. 17. But since the end of the year, so then it was already 18. The following year, we got married, also on December 20th. And then the following
year.
Two years. Bad with the years these days because the pandemic. And then we had Liam. His name is Liam, and he's 6 months now. But
and did you have him here in Miami? You came to Miami for the pandemic, right?
Yeah.
Yes, that's correct.
Yes, he's a pandemic baby. But
And then so you had Liam, you had literally a baby in arms, right? When you were teaching this piece about an angel, a husband, a woman's dream of having a baby. Mm-hmm. And dancers at Dimensions, what was that like?
That was super special because again, like the theme is like so cyclical for me because going back when Carlos and Jen were like, oh, set Dimensions. And then when they told us the dancers we were setting it on, all those dancers are very good friends of mine. I grew up dancing with them. Mm-hmm. Like, so it was beautiful to share this experience. And also we brought Liam with us. Mm-hmm. He would sit there in his little car seat and like hold off. And, or sometimes like Jen would hold him for me while we
demonstrate. And Carlos.
And it was so beautiful because it was, those days that we got to rehearse, like everything that was happening was truly like a dream come true of mine. That's how, and I'm sure they can relate because they have Ava and they know what that feels like, but that is, it's something that I always dreamed of, you know, just like the piece was something I always dreamed of, like, you know, getting married and having a family with Levon. And then also, I guess that also reflected in being able to work artistically and have my family involved. So for me, it was super meaningful.
No, and also I want to say that we are super grateful with Jen and Carlos. That like from the first day that we stepped into Dimensions to set this piece, and we brought Liam because we had to, and they were with open arms. They were so friendly, and I don't know, we were blessed that we were working and we're still working with them, because it doesn't feel like working. It feels like we're going to a home and they're part of our family, and they took Liam with super open arms and help us to set the piece while they were carrying our son, you know. So it's a blessing. It's a blessing. They're really true, like they're beautiful people, you know, and it is, it's good to work with people like them.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So we're almost, we have 4 minutes. So I want to say that gave me chills, but it's also, again, such a beautiful example of taking dance to the next generation. And Jennifer and Carlos, how, what was that like for you? You've brought up a child while you've been raising your company, and then to welcome Melissa and Levon and their baby to work with the company. What was it like for you to see that?
I mean, honestly, it wasn't even a second thought for us. You know, it's normal. It's normal. And Liam is a part of who they are. And so it was our absolute joy and pleasure to have him in the studio and to see Melissa, especially because we had worked with her before she was a mom, mm-hmm. as a choreographer. You know, she set a piece on our dancers before. And so to see how her dynamic has shifted a little bit now that she is a mom, and how she was balancing the two at the same time was a beautiful thing. I think it's a beautiful thing for our dancers to see. I'm super proud that she's able to do that and that we can help her do that. Sometimes I feel like dancers feel like they have to choose between motherhood and a career as a dancer or a choreographer, and it's not, that choice is not necessary. I think you can definitely do both, and being a mother can certainly enhance, or even being a father certainly enhance what you're doing as an artist. And so to have the baby in the studio was a blessing for all of us.
For all of us. And yeah, it was funny because sometimes she had to show the choreography and she had the baby, right? And teach the girls steps. And then she was like, which is just normal. Like, just like here, hold him. And then he started crying. We go outside, we walk with him. But you know, it's beautiful and brought us
back memories. You
know? And I remember Miami City LA when she had to do rehearsals or full rehearsal with both of us, because we used to dance together a lot, you know, hand the baby to another dancer. Can you hold it like here, you know, like, so. It was beautiful. Mm-hmm. And as Jennifer was saying, it was beautiful for the dancers to see that too. And it was a great opportunity to work with them once again. They're beautiful people, beautiful dancers. So, you know, and I'm very talented choreographers too, as well. And so, you know, we are very happy that we are able to do this piece that we've been talking for a while.
Yeah.
And we just haven't been able wanted to choose the right program where to put it in, that it fit. And, you know, that's what is our program now. This time it has neoclassical, more a little bit classical, and then it has modern as well. So that's what we want to give our dancers, so they can, they don't get stuck dancing just only one style of dance. We want to make them more versatile. Mm-hmm. So, and for the audience as well.
So we have to wrap up. It's 8:00. I'll say quickly that as a mother, and a lover and close observer and chronicler of the arts in Miami for several decades, many parts of this conversation give me chills for different reasons. Thank you, all of you, for talking so openly and honestly about some personal subjects and some artistic subjects. Thank you to the South Miami-Dade Cultural Arts Center for hosting this discussion. The performance is July 17th and 18th. You can get tickets on the center website, and I'm gonna turn it back over to Annie to close us out. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you so much to our incredible moderator, Jordan Levin, and to our amazing panelists for participating in our dance talk. And thank you to all of you for joining us. We do hope to see you in person on Saturday, July 17th at 8 p.m. and Sunday, July 18th at 3 p.m. As Jordan said, tickets are available on our website at smdcac.org. Thank you so much and have a great night.